pleasure to be here. And I was noticing, as Ann was describing me, she said he has, I think the phrase was, a deep, profound interest or something like that in guns. No, Holland Gunner, okay? See, she was saying it in a nice, polite way. Holland Gunner, okay? And you'll hear what that means in a few minutes. What I'm going to do today, I've been, as you can imagine, I'm busy last week or so. But this is somewhere between 250 and 300 public appearances that I've made over the last 5 or 6 years. I don't do it as much as I used to because I hate planes, so I like to stay within driving distance of where I live, which is outside of Springfield, Massachusetts. But what I tend to do, what I'm invited to do, is exactly why I'm here today, to share what I know about guns, because I've been in the business in every way for over 50 years. I not only was a retailer, I was a manufacturer, wholesaler, importer. I am a trainer in 6 different training categories. Certified by the NRA, but actually most of my training I now do is certifying police departments, federal agencies actually, to make sure they can hit the broad side of the barn.
Mike, may I interrupt you a moment? Can everyone hear Mike okay? If not, we can give you a microphone if you like one. Can everyone hear Mike okay?
Good.
We can give you a cordless mic.
If I could stand over here, then you'll be over here. And then we'll be. All right, anyway, while that's going on, okay, if that, oh, that's fine. See, I don't like the things wrapped around my head, that's what I don't like. Okay, now you all hear me? Good. All right, in about, great. All right, now. So, what I like to do is to come to groups like this, particularly of people who are concerned about gun violence, but may not themselves really understand the whole spectrum of the gun experience, and I can help you to a little, you know, to a degree to understand that spectrum better. I started in the gun business in 1964. I had a great uncle in North Carolina, and he had a machine shop, and he started making one of those little Saturday night specials. And, actually, I haven't got any gun business even there. All right. What I'm really going to talk about today is virtuous violence, okay? And I'm going to tie it into what's been going on in Washington last week, as well as to what you folks are doing in this wonderful organization that you have. But I think it's an issue that is rarely mentioned in the context of conversations about guns, and yet when all is said and done, it's what stands behind this entire question in terms of how we deal with the issue of what guns are capable of doing, mainly injuring people. Okay. What do I mean by virtuous violence? My father was in the Navy in World War II. He helped plan the first amphibious landing invasion in the Pacific, which was Kwajalein, the Gilbert Islands. He was part of the planning team, and then he went on the to Kwajalein. Luckily, he didn't have to go in until the second day. We went to Kwajalein. It was our first amphibious landing in the Pacific, January of 43, because allegedly the island was very lightly defended. And it was very lightly defended because it was not particularly a strategic point. And since we had screwed up the landings in North Africa in 42, we figured, oh, well, this time we better get it right. So let's do one where we won't have a lot of fire, you know, a lot of troops that firing at us and going to Kwajalein. So my father was part of the planning team. He was in the old Navy Yard down in Washington, D.C. And then they all went out to the Pacific. I was
born following, near the end of 44. Obviously, he came back from Kwajalein. And he told me that when he went on shore the second day, even though this was a light invasion, it only took, you know, less than a division to go on, you know, to take the island, he couldn't believe the physical devastation that he saw. The bodies on the surf. The parts of bodies. Okay? He'd never seen anything like that in his life. Okay? But you know, the truth is that we, the American army that went in there, we committed that violence. Our soldiers aimed their guns at the enemy, pulled the trigger thousands of times, okay? And yet, we all felt, those of us who were alive in 1943, we felt that we were using violence to do a good thing. Okay? Now, if you were a citizen living in Dresden when the RAF came over and leveled the city, or if you were somebody living in Hiroshima when the Enola Gay dropped the bomb, you wouldn't have felt that you deserved to be a victim of virtuous violence, but yet to the average American, that was something that we should have done. My point is that we are talking about a particular kind of violence, violence caused by guns, and the World Health Organization defines violence as any conscious attempt by any person to harm themselves or harm anybody else. That's the medical definition of violence. And it's a serious problem for medicine, because if you injure somebody, they gotta fix it, if they can. The World Health Organization has spent a lot of time, came up with this definition a number of years ago. Okay? But the truth is that in many cases, we decide, or we agree, that in harming, not ourselves so much, but in harming somebody else, we're doing it for a good reason. We're doing it because it should be done, or can be done. And this is the problem that you're going to face in terms of talking to people about their ownership of guns and how guns are used. Because right now, it is the gun-owning lobby, if you want to say that, the gun industry and its representatives, who have fashioned an argument in which they basically are saying that we should have guns because we can use them in a good way. And that's what the virtuous violence argument is all about. In 1960, Gallup ran a national poll. They do it now every 2 years, but they did it for the first time in 1960. The question was, they asked a cross-section of Americans, should there be a ban on handgun ownership? Not stricter licensing, not, you know, vetting, none of that stuff, an absolute ban. 60% of the respondents said yes to a ban. If that majority had carried over into a law, we would have had, at that point in time, the same kind of access to guns that you have in the rest of the advanced world, the OECD countries, namely more or less access to long guns, rifle, shotguns, but handguns, no. And guess what? If we had done that in 1960, if we had followed what a majority of the country believed at that time, there wouldn't be any gun violence. Because gun violence is a function, overwhelmingly, notwithstanding the assault rifle issue, which I'll get to in a couple of minutes, gun violence is overwhelmingly a function of the fact that we are the only country, the only advanced country, that has legal access to handguns. Okay? And every time that the GVP, you know what I mean by GVP, gun violence prevention, that's you folks, okay? Every time the GVP community puts forth an idea for better regulation, they like to call it responsible regulation, but I'll get to that word in a minute too. Every time they put this forward, invariably it's something that has to do with those little things in the pocket called handguns. Because we're not really worried about those old rusty shotguns that Grandpa has in the basement. They don't kill anything. It's the handguns. And the moment you say that, what does the other side say? They say, oh, no. You can't take my handguns away because I have a Second Amendment right to have a gun. And not only do I have a Second Amendment right to have a gun, but I want to have a handgun because I'm going to use that handgun to protect myself against somebody who wants to hurt me. Okay? Right now, the best studies that we have from my friends at Harvard, they updated what Phil Cook did 20 years ago. Roughly somewhere around 35% of American households claim to have a legal gun. Okay? But the last time that Gallup asked whether or not a gun in the home was a positive thing as opposed to a risk to protect you from a criminal attack, 60% of the people who answered the poll said yes. So obviously, the whole idea of not only having that gun because the Constitution said I can have it, but because I want to have it, because I want to protect myself, that idea has become mainstream. It's become not just something held by people with guns, but a lot of other people as well. So, if you're going to go out and you're going to present to a legislator, legislative committee, or something like that, if you're going to present an idea, a sensible, rational, reasonable idea, that you think would reduce gun violence, see, what you're going to run up against is a very large opinion that says, sorry, guns are a good thing. Now, I'm not here to tell you, I'm not here to make you feel that what you're doing is going to, it won't work, or, give me a couple minutes, but I'll get to that. By the way, how much time should I be talking? I can talk anywhere from 2 minutes to 2 hours.
We said we would wrap up the program by 11:30, so.
Woo! Okay.
We'll see how the Q&A goes. You're going to leave time for Q&A anyway.
Oh, I like the Q&A, because then I can shut up for a couple minutes. Yeah. I mentioned the Second Amendment. Let me get to the Second Amendment. Okay? In 2008, the court, under the direction of the one at that time gun nut on the bench, Tony Scalia, I know it's Antonin Scalia, but let me tell you something, I'm from the same neighborhood Queens that he's from, and a Queen that wasn't Scalia, Scalia, okay. And I once spent a night with him in a dinner at Harvard, and so he was a true gun nut, although I didn't know that much. Anyway, okay. But what the court said in 2008, see, and I need to point this out to you, I need to talk a little bit about this, because that's always what comes up every time you want to go before a committee or talk to people, hey, my Second Amendment, well, you got to know what it really means, okay? So what the court said was that you, as an American, had the constitutional right to keep a gun in your home, even a handgun in your home, even if you weren't using it for military service. There was, you could keep it constitutional right. You had private ownership of that handgun. That's what the court said in 2008, and that's all they said. Now, back. I bought my first real gun in 1956. I was 12 years old. I went down to Florida. My parents were moving from D.C. back to New York. They didn't want me on the foot during the summertime. Oh, up here? Oh, no. And the Statue of Liberty. They sent me down to Florida to be with my great uncle Nat, who I really loved. He was my grandfather's brother. I didn't like my grandfather so much, but I liked his brother. So we're driving around the day before I have to get back on the train and go back up to D.C. We're going up Highway 441, a big straight road that goes from Miami up to Palm Beach, about 8 miles from the coast. In those days, that was the border. The west side of that road was the swamp, completely. Now it's nothing but condos. But anyway, we were driving up the road. And we passed by this like little clearing in the swamp, and they're having a tag sale. And I walked, we got out of the car and walked around. And I go by this table. An old boy's got a bunch of blue Smith & Wesson boxes with real Smiths. Oh my God. See, I was a typical kid in the 50s. I had three hobbies: toy soldiers, toy trains, toy guns. That's what you did in the 50s if you were a boy, right? So I'm seeing, you know how many times I was maybe 9 years old when I earned enough money to go down a hardware store in a corner and buy Daisy Red Ryzen BB gun rifle, you know, which was a copy of the old Winchester 94, the gun that won the West, you know. You know how many times, don't get upset when I say what I'm going to say. I'm just trying to give you a little bit of the culture. You know how many times I killed Geronimo in the backyard with that gun? That's what the culture was in the 50s. Okay? So, I had all kinds of toy guns. And by the way, my parents were liberals and educated, but it wasn't the kind of thing where you defined yourself, well, I'm not going to let my children have a gun the way they do today. No, no, no. It was a very different atmosphere. Okay? So anyway, I'm standing there looking at the real thing. Oh my God, it's so real. So I said to the guy, I said, can I buy one of these? And he didn't ask me how old I was. He said, you a Florida resident? I said, well, no, sir. He said, well, I'll tell you what. He said, got $50 on you? I said, yes, sir, because my parents are giving me some money, you know. He says, well, you see that old boy over there? I said, yes. He said, you go over there, you give him the $50, he'll give you the gun. That was my first straw set. So I bought my first personal gun, 1956. From 56 until 2008, the Supreme Court decision, 53 years, I personally bought and sold, just for myself, 500 guns. That's not a lot. That's 10 guns a year. For a gun nut, that's nothing. Okay? That's nothing. During that same 52-year period, when I was personally buying and selling 50 guns, the American civilian gun arsenal grew by 150 million guns. Okay? Between 1956 and 2008. Because the civilian arsenal in 56 was around 60 million guns. By 2008, it's 230 million guns. Okay? And as part of that, as an importer and as a manufacturer and so forth, I also, to the market, sold 50 or 60,000 guns. The point is that not one of those transactions had any Second Amendment protection at all. And yet, they were all legal. Nobody was made vulnerable. Nobody was indicted for, you know, breaking some kind of federal law. The point I'm making here is that the whole idea that the Second Amendment has kind of opened the floodgates, you see, is simply not true. The floodgates have always been open, Second Amendment or not. And the reason I point this out is that too often I'll hear somebody who is a, you know, concerned about gun violence and is talking in front of a mixed audience or an audience with a lot of gun people, and invariably, before they get to the fourth sentence, they say, now understand, I'm not against the Second Amendment, I'm in favor of the Second Amendment. The moment they say that, all the gun people know that they're against it. Okay, I guarantee it. Because the narrative has become, because of this whole issue of virtuous violence, the narrative has become that if you want to regulate the gun industry, which is what you have to do, it's a consumer industry, they make a product, you know. If you want to regulate that industry, you are in some way or another regulating the behavior of the people who enjoy being part of that industry as consumers. And so the moment you do that, what the industry responds is, you're against Second Amendment rights because they've created a narrative that a majority of Americans believe that anybody should be able to get their hands on a gun. Well, wait a minute, you say, what about all those, you know, criminal, Let me break the news to you gently, okay? 70% of the gun violence that occurs in this country, 75%, okay? It doesn't matter whether the gun was legal or not. And in most cases, we can't even figure out whether it's a legal gun or not, because who knows who bought it after I bought it and I sold it and he gave it and then, you know the whole story, okay? So the point is, don't get yourselves hung up as advocates for gun safety, as advocates for responsible, as advocates for reasonable regulations, don't get hung up on the issue of anybody's Second Amendment rights. It doesn't matter, and it's not what the argument is really all about. Okay? Now, talking about reasonable, responsible. You see, I have a little problem. The problem is that if you want to be part of the gun industry as a consumer, how many people here are gun nuts besides me? One, I know, yeah, he's a libertarian guy. Okay, how many guns do you own?
Over 10.
Over 10, well, how many? 50? 40? Like 12?
Over the years.
No, right now. In your, yeah. How many guns do you want?
Five.
I used to have these two young men who ran my retail shop. I don't do retail because the two kids who were doing it, who ran the shop, they both got real jobs in law enforcement, and I didn't trust people, you know, I didn't know them. I think they had 260 guns in the house. I think. My God, what did I do? Pairs of shoes my wife has in the house. It's a hobby, folks. It's something that people enjoy. Okay? I mean, the only reason, no, not the only reason. The reason that I got pissed off at the NRA, okay, and started writing and coming out, and of course, as I am, by the way, a lifetime Patriot Endowment member. Pretty high rank. I've actually done booths at the NRA show. I know Wayno, I mean, okay. What pissed me off about the NRA, got me started, was the fact that they changed the messaging from what it was when I joined. And the messaging when I joined, when I was 11 years old, was that guns were used for hunting and sport. That was it. Okay? And in fact, I joined because I was in a rifle team that practiced in the very nice rifle range in my brother's junior high school. And Friday afternoon, we had 22 these old little bolt-action training rifles that the military got rid of after the war. You know how old I am when I say the war, okay? And Friday, I could take my guns home, you know, a little sack, put it under my arm, walk home about a mile, and then clean it, play with it, and everything else, okay? Now, you might think this was in Topeka, Kansas. No, this is in the middle of Washington, D.C. That's what the gun business was like in the 1950s. You could walk up Georgia Avenue in the Petworth District with a rifle under your arm and nobody cared. All right, but anyway, that to me was what shooting was all about. It's a hobby, it's a sport, okay? And when in the 1980s, late 80s, the gun industry realized that people like me were not going to be replaced by the next generation, they had to come up with a new narrative. And the new narrative was virtuous violence, protect yourself from crime. And all of a sudden, the whole idea is you can walk around with a gun on your pocket, whether you're trained or not. Okay? Because the NRA and the gun industry has never and will never support issuance of concealed carry where you have to have mandated training. Because mandated training means the government has to do it. Mandated training means it'll take a long time. Mandated training means gun sales will go down. So, what you end up with is this kind of crazy idea that somebody can walk into a gun shop in my state. By the way, Massachusetts is considered the second most regulated gun state in the United States. Okay. In the second most regulated gun state in the United States, you take a 2-hour safety course before you apply for your gun license. Okay? You sit there while somebody drones from a book about this and about that. You don't even have to actually shoot a gun. Then you go and you get your license. Okay? You come back, you walk into the shop, you buy a gun. You put ammunition into it, you put the gun in your pocket, you walk out because you're going to defend the world against God knows who. Okay? That's all the training you need. In other words, none. And the fact is that the gun industry promotes this because they want to sell guns. I don't blame them. That's their product. Fine. But you've got a problem because if you're going to come out against this, if you're going to suggest something reasonable like mandated training, okay, then you're going to, again, run into the argument that, well, I need that gun. I need that gun. I need to protect myself with that gun. Okay, this is I'm going to go about 5 more minutes and then we'll give you all a chance to come up and yell at me. Yesterday, the RAND Corporation, you all know who they are, the thinking group out there in California. The RAND Corporation got in on the act, because this week everybody who knows anything or thinks they know anything about guns is going to publish something, if everybody's interested in it. So they published this, they dredged up this survey they did 3 years ago, in which they evaluated all the different research that's been done, and they evaluated to determine whether or not all the research really proves this or that or the other thing about what we need to do to keep guns safe, okay? And they determined that most of the research doesn't definitively prove that this strategy or that strategy or background checks or anything else will actually work. Okay. Well, the truth is, there's no research that could prove it, but forget that, okay? So then, the New York Times took this big report from RAND, and about a week ago, they called 29 gun researchers around the country and asked them all to look at the report and then say, you know, is RAND right? And what the gun researchers said, of course, was, yeah, the The report is right. We need more research on this, we need more research on that, we need more research on blah, 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 blah. Wrong. It's a terrible article. And the reason it's a terrible article is because there's only one thing that we need research on. We need research so that we will know how to talk to somebody who really believes that he needs or she needs that gun to protect themselves from somebody else. And the problem is that we're all, if you look around the room, we're all educated people. Many of us are professionals. And so we're used to thinking that you don't want to form an argument, you don't want to form an opinion about something unless you have what we call database information, unless you have some facts, okay? So, if we don't have enough research, we can't form an opinion, blah, 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 blah. Well, let me tell you something. The other side doesn't need research. The other side doesn't need facts. The other side owns guns because something makes them think that they'll be safer with that gun. When in fact, occasionally people, you know, are confronted by a threat, are confronted by somebody who steals from them, breaks into their house. Doesn't mean that if they had a gun, they'd be able to successfully defend themselves anyway. But the real problem is, believe it or not, even with the terrible event in Florida, the horrible thing in Las Vegas, gun violence statistically and geographically is a rare event. Last year, 73 or 74,000 people decided that they really wanted to hurt somebody else, and they did it by using a gun called aggravated assault. And if the bullet hit the right spot, the aggravated assault becomes a homicide. But the total was around 75,000 times. You know how many times somebody in America decided last year that they really wanted to hurt somebody else? 2 million. That's the number of aggravated, that's serious injury done each year. Now, how is it that 2 million people each year decide that they really want to knock somebody else over the head, really hurt them, and they do it, and yet only 75,000 of these 2 million decide to do it with a gun? It's not like they can't get their hands on guns. So it's a rare event because, as you know, it happens very frequently in certain areas, and in other areas it doesn't happen at all. Mm-hmm. How many shootings you have here in the town in the last couple of years, brother? None. Thank you.
In Devon or in the county?
Yeah, right here, right here.
In Devon,
we
had murder suicide.
Okay. Oh, murder suicide. By the way, you should do some work on that. There's more of that than people know. More of that than people know. Okay? Because it's often not classified that way. But the bottom line is.
There was one half a mile.
Okay.
Right.
But that's one, two, and. Okay.
And there was one with a roadside shooting a mile from where I live.
Okay, no, I'm not saying it doesn't happen, but let me tell you something. If the number of people who checked into a hospital in Philadelphia for symptoms of Ebola was the same as the number of people who went to that hospital the same day with bullet wounds, the entire state of Pennsylvania would be empty of human beings within 24 hours. Remember the great Ebola epidemic? Remember, okay? Guess what? That epidemic in West Africa, because it affected basically four countries, killed less people than the number of people who are killed each year in this country with guns. Okay?
Mike, can we answer questions now? Because I do want to leave the group plenty of time for that.
And I'm done in one more second. And yet, okay, if it wasn't for these mass shootings, these crazy, you know, things, would we ever think about, on a daily basis, those 30,000 who die every year? Okay. Would it be part of the narrative of our daily lives? That's the problem that you face. You have to inject that narrative into the daily discussion that you have with people, because if you don't do it, they're not going to hear about it any other way. Okay, I'm going to quit.
Okay. So, if you have a question, Greg will come to you with the microphone, and you may ask, and then Mike will respond.
And I'll answer briefly. I'm going to the phone.
I agree with you, Mike. I think we put way too much emphasis on facts. I think facts only appeal to overeducated people. You just enunciated the narrative that the NRA and the gun manufacturers have to support our current craziness. So what, instead of offering statistics, what narrative should those of us who favor greater regulation, what narrative should we be speaking?
Why are people buying guns? Because they're afraid of something. They're afraid of crime. They may be afraid of losing the guns. It is an industry in terms of consumer choice that's driven by fear. What the gun violence prevention community has to figure out is a narrative that they can use that will acknowledge those fears, but give people other ways to deal with their fear.
Such as?
What?
Such as.
Good question. I'm serious. I don't come here with a lot of it, but I will say this, and I don't want to go into long detail. Next week, if you read my column, if you read my website, one of the first columns, I'm going to go after one of the medical societies, the American College of Emergency Physicians, because it turns out that they have a PAC and they're giving a huge amount of money to certain Republican politicians who are very pro-gun, okay? Now, I'm sure that a lot of the doctors who are members of the ASAP don't know that the PAC is doing this, okay? But the whole point of my column is going to be to point this out. What I'm really going to go do with that is go further into the whole issue of all the medical societies, because I know people in all of them, and I ran a medical society myself for several years. Such as, I would imagine that if everybody in this room sat down and made a list of the organizations and groups that they are a part of on a regular basis, we got 50 people in a room, I bet you it'd be 500 different organizations. And the way that you deal with people is organizationally, small groups, one-on-one. I don't know what I would suggest as an alternative, but I'll tell you this. When I talk directly to somebody and I say, are you buying that gun because you're afraid? If they say yes, the conversation always turns in a very interesting way. It always does. Okay?
That lady raised her hand.
I think
there
was one
of the things that's always been difficult for me to understand is why I can't have a rocket grenade launcher, but I can have a semi-automatic weapon. I mean, where do you draw a line? I mean, I actually like a 40mm anti-aircraft.
Why can't you have a 40mm anti-aircraft gun? Of course you can.
You can?
Yeah.
So I can have a rocket grenade launcher?
Damn right. You can have a Sherman tank. Well, an Abrams tank. Quick answer, but I need... Okay. First gun law that the federal government ever passed was the National Firearms Act of 1934. This was the law that decided that certain types of weapons, not guns, weapons, were too dangerous to be in ordinary gun commerce. And what was moving them was the big Thompson machine gun, you know, and Al Capone, okay, fine. But the bottom line is that you can own a Thompson machine gun, you can own a rocket launcher, blah, 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 but in order to do so, you have to go through a vetting and a background check process that takes about 6 months, and it'll cost you $250 for a stamp, okay? Over 60,000 fully automatic machine guns are owned by civilians in this country, and there have been exactly 2 homicides from machine guns in the last 70 years. Why? Because by the time you get through that whole process of getting licensed, the licensing, you know, makes you aware of how important it is to, first of all, to store the gun properly, and secondly, to make sure that it's always used in a proper way. The law does not say guns, it says weapons. And the law has been defined as a weapon being anything that can fire a projectile based on the explosion of powder. Isn't that your anti-tank gun? Okay, fine. So, go get one and go to, and seriously, and go to a class, what's called an NFA Class B dealer, and give them $250 and fill out the form and wait 6 months and blah, 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 blah. Okay? He doesn't believe me, but I'm telling you the truth. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. You've had 2 Tommy Gun, Al Capone shootings, or whatever. Is it the same law that's allowing people to have the handguns? Do they have to go through the same process of 6 months?
Allowing them to have what?
Well, to get the same process to get handguns as it is.
No, no. The difference is that in virtually 43 out of the 50 states, the licensing process for getting a handgun consists only of walking into the gun shop and waiting for about a minute while the dealer calls the FBI and does a background check. Well, I say, well, listen, in 1960, a majority of Americans thought that that was a great idea. And if we licensed handguns the way they're licensed in Europe, by the way, the European countries modeled their gun laws on our NFA 34 law, except they included handguns in what they considered to be dangerous weapons. See, we have one big problem in this country in terms of the industry. Guns are the only consumer product which are primarily regulated not by how the product is designed and works, but how the owner of the product behaves. Everything else that you buy is regulated in terms of safety by the design of the product. And if it's considered unsafe, remember the old cribs where the kids could stick their heads between, okay? All right? With guns, we don't do that. When we went to the big regulatory event, which was the Gun Control Act of 1968, we dropped the whole idea of regulating the product and moved to regulating the person.
What about cars? Isn't that a counterexample? Cars are regulated by the person who drives it.
No, they're not. They are regulated in terms of safety by the design. And then, of course, we add to that certain behavior things like speeding and the like. But what's brought down car fatalities is all the public health research that showed that some things like seatbelts, things like better crash and so forth would make a fundamental difference in the car.
So I have, what I'm looking for is some solutions. And what I'm hearing is not solutions. I know personally, because my family, I have a nephew that tells me he owns 40 guns. I have tried to talk to him. I don't have the language. I don't have that process. What are the steps that go toward bridging the divide? You mentioned fear. I mean, I think there are groups that intentionally whip up fears of the other. They're very powerful. How does one address that group? There are people who, some immigration issue is tied into that, the dangerous other, the self-protection. How do you start to unravel this intentionally generated fear, which has is supported by many groups, including some of the fundamentalist churches, including big organizations who have a vested interest in dividing people and keeping them afraid of each other? If you want to divide, if you want to bridge that divide, and if you want people to feel like they don't have to be afraid of each other and they don't have to kill each other, how do you start to have that conversation?
Well, I think the issue that you're raising is really not an issue about guns.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
And you know, to be honest with you, I don't know. I mean, I don't know if you put me in a room and you said, here are three people who are very opposed to immigration because they think all the killers are coming in, I'll be honest with you, I wouldn't know how to respond. I'm not opposed to immigration at all, so you know.
But if a group like this is to be effective, is that not the issue that we must address?
No, because I think at that point, in a way, the argument loses a certain focus. And rather than addressing, you know, the fear of immigrants, I think the issue has to be whether or not you need to carry a gun. And as I say, I'm not saying it doesn't happen, okay? But the number of people who on a daily basis actually find that having a gun will help them, okay, is a very small number. And I will tell you this, I sometimes talk to groups, very, very aggressive, very rabid gun people. And I've said to them, hey, listen, any of you ever actually had to use the gun? And no hand goes up. And at that point, the argument changes right there. Right there, because they realize that they're not promoting or holding on to something because it happened. They realize that they're holding on to it for some reason, some vague, I don't know what. And you know, it's not an easy sell. It's not an easy sell. Listen, my mother was pregnant with me in 1944, and a doctor told her she couldn't smoke. When did they put the warning on the cigarette pack?
So I'm going to ask a question here. One of the big changes, in my personal opinion, was many states moving from may issue for concealed carry permits to shall issue. The difference being, under may issue, the county sheriff who issues those licenses, at least here in Pennsylvania, is looking for a reason why you would need to be concealed carrying a gun. And shall issue is they have to have a good reason to deny you permission. So it became a lot easier to get a concealed carry license. So is that one of the changes that we could make to try to reduce the presence in all of the shared spaces in our communities?
Actually, it wasn't the case that a lot of states went from may to shall. It was the case that a lot of states had nothing. And the issuing authority, whether it was the sheriff or whoever it was, made his rules up as it went along. And because gun owners saw this as a, precisely because there was no law, it wasn't like they had to change the law. They had to, you know, put a law in. They were able to do it, they, you know, because it wasn't like, well, first of all, there wasn't that much opposition. Nobody really cared. And secondly, you know, I have to tell you that to me the issue is not whether you need to prove a reason to own a gun, you know, to walk around with a gun. To me the issue is whether or not the society approves of anybody with a very, very lethal item who doesn't know how to use it. That's to me the issue. And if there was a really serious mandated training, first of all, a lot of people wouldn't take it because it's too much trouble. So right there you cut down the number of people walking around with a gun. But the bottom line is, it's not people who are walking around with the guns who are committing all the gun violence, who are legally walking around with the guns, whether it's Shall or me. That's not who's committing the gun violence. We have 400,000 handguns that are stolen every year in this country. And if you put, you know, so we got a stolen arsenal now in the millions. There's no real attempt to control that in any way. The cops don't really care if you lose your gun. They don't have time for that.
So we're going to wrap up. I'm going to ask you, because back to the solutions question, because we all spend a lot of time, you included, Mike, looking for a better path forward. So can you give us two or three things that you believe are most worth pursuing for a better path forward?
Every year when I did my retail, my shop was in a town where if you want to get a job, you leave. So the population of the town is seniors, retired, old people. The kids are gone. And every couple of weeks, every month, the kids would come back. Grandpa's dropped dead, grandma's gone into the nursing home, clean out the house, goodbye, farewell. And down in the basement, they find a bunch of rusty old guns. They call the chief up. Hey, chief, what do we do with these guns? Hey, give me the mic. He'll give you $10 a piece. Fine. So every year I would have in my gun shop a whole rack of old clunkers. Many didn't even work, okay? Single shot shotguns, old crap, whatever. And around Christmas time, they really sell. $30-$40, put a gun under the tree. Fine. Okay. If somebody walks into my gun shop or any gun shop in the United States and wants to buy one of these guns, that person has to jump through the same legal hoops that you got to jump through if you walk in and buy a Glock pistol that holds 18 rounds or an AR-15 that can shoot 60 rounds in a minute or less. That to me is absurd. I've never understood why the gun violence prevention community doesn't begin pushing the idea of regulation based on lethality. Okay? Because nobody's going to kill anybody but themselves with one of these old shotguns if they put new ammo in it and the barrel blows up. That's it. So the first thing I would love to see is focusing on the lethality of guns. And lethality just doesn't mean the ammunition. A gun that fits in a pocket like this is very lethal because nobody can see it when you're walking around in a crowd. So lethality has to be understood as not only what the gun is, you know, how the gun is used in the ballistics, but how the person could use it in a lethal and unsafe way. Okay. So number one, there has to be gradations of regulation in terms of lethality of the product. Second thing I would say is, and I've just mentioned this before, that if we all believe in the Second Amendment, which I don't, then at the very least, there ought to be a very serious push towards mandated training. Mandated, serious, continuous training. You don't go once, you gotta come back. And finally, most important, I think, and this is something the gun nuts really hate, there has to be some kind of accountability in which it's like the car. When you buy a car, okay, they want to know where that car is. Because they're going to charge you an excise tax or what every year. I don't think there's such a big deal about showing up in a police station once a year and saying, these are the guns that I own. Period. That's what I had last year. That's what I had this year. Because that would really make people think twice about what they're doing to safely store their guns. And if you think for one second that by a bunch of people walking into the police station in my town, that now the government could take away all their guns, You have no idea how that local police department is. Trust me, the last thing they want is thinking they can do it. Well, I'm not national, I'm talking about local, the issuing authority, okay?
Huge membership of people that probably think a lot like you. I mean, well, a lot of people that don't think like you, but there is a group of people that do think like you. Is there a potential for that group?
How many people were involved in the kind of activity that you're doing right now 10 years ago? One, two, three, four, okay? You're a very new breed. The NRA has been in business since 1876. The fact that they have 4 million members, actually it's about 3.5 real members, okay, is a function of the fact that they do a very good care and feeding of their membership. I'm just beginning to see gun violence organizations becoming membership organizations. It takes time. And as that grows and develops, then the playing field levels out.
Thank you.